Šodien mēs svinam Kristu.
And today we are celebrating the resurrection of Christ.
Nevienā citā pasaules reliģijā tādu nav.
We don't have anything else in other religions of the world. Other gods died, were buried, and only graves are now after them. But the grave of our Lord Jesus is empty. If you go to Jerusalem, they would show the place, which is empty. Graves are usually not empty because that people don't walk away, but there is one. Maybe it is the right one, maybe not. But it's not so important. Apostle Paul was writing to us that already through his life he met more than 400 eyewitnesses who were eating together with him, with Jesus, and who met Jesus after his resurrection. And we also know that all the 12 disciples who were in this upper room, where he went after the resurrection, all 12 disciples proved with their death, with the death of blood witness, that what they are speaking is really truth. Apostle Paul was saying, if Christ wasn't resurrected, then there is no resurrection at all. Then everything that we have in this world is just sufferings and sufferings till the pit. And then all our loved ones and relatives stand around us and say, sleep well, sleep well. But as all of us, we know there is no good sleep over there. Nobody wants it. But Christ has resurrected. And that means that there is resurrection for the dead people. And that means that you and me, you and me, we are part of it. And all people will stand in front of God, in front of His throne. And you know, during the life, sometimes probably you have also met people who are that, how can I ask Him something? And I will say something to God, but when you see God, you will be able to do only what those Roman soldiers were able to do. They were scared, they couldn't move even a finger when He came out of His grave. And you know, when I was listening to those life stories, I had to think about two things. What I am not surprised of. First of all, I am not surprised of that people have problems. There are problems in lives. Remember Romans 3? Apostle Paul is saying that everybody has sinned and everybody lacked the glory of God. And also in the Bible it's written that the consequences of the sin is consequence of sin is death. Sometimes sins are promising special feelings, moments of happiness, shortcuts to happiness, riches, influence. But everything that comes of sin is death. And in some people's lives, this death is very securely hidden. And nobody can see it. But in other people's lives, this sin can be seen very clearly. But still, everybody needs salvation. Whatever situation you are in. And if somebody is lucky to go through these situations. In the end, there is the last enemy. Nobody was able to fight against, except one, and this is death. And at the end of the life. So this life, 80 or more years, they pass quickly. And then people discover that they haven't participated in reality in their lives. But thanks to Jesus,
Tātad es nebrīnos par to, ka cilvēku
so I'm not surprised that there are a lot of problems in the lives of people and or we can say consequences of sin which are which is death. Everybody is facing it. Even though how happy they look, how intellectual, influential, or happy they look like, in all the areas of their life there is death. Only if they have allowed Jesus Christ to save them, then they are alive, but otherwise they have problems. And second thing I'm not surprised of is that God helps people.
And
already in Christmas we know the story that Jesus' baby was born and put in the manger, and we know this is a story about love, about willingness to come closer to people. People are such a value for Almighty God that He is looking for their hearts and knocking and wants people to understand and trust Him. But you know, when we read what Jesus says, then people who are intellectual and thinking and know that the words of Jesus are truth and nothing more, nothing is exaggerated, no, it is a pure truth.
And then
we would need in surprise and shock to start thinking. Because when Jesus speaks about his relationship with God and God's relationship with people, he's saying something which is hard to understand. Can it be reality? And I would just mention a couple of scriptures this morning. And the first one is from John 15, verse 9, starting with verse 9. And what is Jesus saying here? As the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love.
Wow! Jesus is three vienības.
Jesus is the second person of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And here he is saying, the same as the Father loves the Son, so I love you. So he loves me like that, and he loves you. In a human way, I can understand, yes, God loves us, but the fact that God loves with such an intensity, with such a devotion, with such a monumental and unchanging love, it is hard to perceive it, right? Jesus loves me the same way as the Father loves the Son. Father God loves Jesus. That makes me to wonder, and also it arouses reverence for God. And he doesn't finish with it. He says, abide in my love. And there are people who have rejected his love because it's not as they wanted or expected or planned. Remember, there was a Neeman
the officer
who went to Elijah to be healed. He was influential, but he had one problem in his life, and he went for healing. But the prophet wasn't doing as he expected, and so he turned his horses around and wanted to leave. And said, if nothing happens like I wanted, it's nothing real. It's like the anecdote where if you don't know somebody, you're nothing. Most of us didn't know God, and thanks God now we know. But He is much more than you and me. When we read the word of His word and also with the guidance of the Holy Spirit, what we can imagine. But thanks God, Naaman had also a very wise soldier who said, okay, if he asks you to do something super complicated, okay, you can leave. But he asked a very simple thing, to go and dip in the river. So he swallowed his pride and did it and received his healing.
Dievs nepiekārtosies tev.
God is not gonna adjust to you. He is God.
Tev nākas pakārtoties.
You need to adjust to God.
Man patīk tas salīdzinājums.
I also like this comparison.
Ots nolaidās uz sliedu,
that the fly went to the railway rails and said,
vilcien.
Train, if you exist, I am challenging you. And nothing happens. And so he says, I proved that there is no train. But for train, he is too tiny particle. So we have to remember that the one who is everything, he loves us, and he wants us to stay in his, to remain in his love. So what does it mean to abide in his love? Sometimes we are thinking that God's love is like a morning dew, and in the morning there is a little bit of this fog, but then it goes away. But Jesus says that God's love would never end. It is unchanging. He loves us, and he wants us to abide in him, to stay with him, and to reply, respond with our love towards him. This is what he is saying here in the second part. He's saying, abide in my love. I want you to love me. Now let us read the next verse, verse 10. And he says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. No, he is not saying that if you don't keep my commandments, I wouldn't love you. No, no, opposite. He is in the previous verses saying that my love belongs to you irrespectively of everything. My Father's heart, the Holy Spirit's heart, belongs to you. But I want you to abide in my love and to love me. This is what his commandments help us to do. Abiding in his word. And then we can love him. Imagine. God wants love from us, and our love means a lot for him. You know, I would like to pose a very courageous statement, which is based in quite a few verses, also in this verse, that Christianity is not a religion. It is love. This is love relationships between Almighty Creator God and the creation, human. This is what love is. Love between the creation and creator. And therefore, Christianity didn't need golden mantles, cathedrals, and so on. It was love between Jesus and his disciples. And today, this is love between the resurrected Lord Jesus and everyone who responds towards his love. In reality, Christianity doesn't work if it is applied as a classical religion. In all religions, there are some methods, some habits, rituals a person has to do in order to become better and become better and better until they achieve some position and is worthy enough to receive salvation. But that doesn't work in Christianity. And maybe that's why we people who had tendencies to build huge cathedrals and create these artworks. And maybe we did it to compensate lack of this personal relationship. But I would like to say that nothing can compensate these personal relationships. People can walk into the huge museum of art and still feel alone, abandoned, and not loved. But the truth is that basically God is so close to this person and wants to be hear him and accept and communicate with him. I love you as Father loves me. And let's look at the next verse, John 15:11. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you. If Jesus was very depressive and in depression and sad, sometimes we see that pastors are like carrying the sin of the whole world. Once I was talking to one of my colleagues who was very serious, and he was saying that it is very difficult to serve God. And I kind of pretended I don't understand anything, and I was asking, are you saying that serving God is very difficult? And he said, yes, it's very difficult. But this contradicts what Jesus says. Jesus says that he has given us his commandments, his orders, not to take the joy away from our life, so that our life is just a slavery and a reminder about sins and about the hell. And if you do very well, then maybe you achieve something, but not a lot of hopes. If Jesus was like that, but Jesus says, may my joy is in you. And if he wasn't joyful, then the disciples would say, it's already difficult. But no, Jesus wasn't sad. He was anointed with oil of joy more than other brothers. And he is saying so that your joy is fulfilled. So a normal position and condition of a Christian is to be joyful. Joyful in sunny days and joyful also in those sad days. Yes, in Christian life, Christian's life also, there are difficult days, days of attack, days when you don't understand, when your closest and most beloved people are rejecting you, they don't understand you, they are blaming you in all sins of the world. Can you be happy also then? Yes, because in this difficult situation, the Christian is not alone. His Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is always with him. And the next scripture talks about that. We are coming to the end of the service very fast, but what is written in Matthew 11, 28-30? I will read it and then we'll talk a little bit about it. So come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know, somebody might read this verse and for somebody for whom it's already difficult and his life is not easy and he is trying to hold on to things in his life. And now he reads this verse, come all those who are laboring and have heavy laden, take my yoke. And one person said to me, I already feel so burdened in my life, I cannot take another yoke. I didn't have a chance to explain to him. He was disappointed and sure that this is a slavery, and he returned back to his miserable existence. And he said it's very difficult. Well, it's according to his words. But what Jesus was really saying, in order to understand it, we need to understand what happened in Jesus' time and what methods were used. So at that time, when at Jesus' time, there were two jobs. fishermen, also people who were farmers and fishermen. So, no, of course, also joiners, carpenters. Jesus was a carpenter. But what were farmers doing? So farmers were plowing the land, and it was very hard and very hard to plow. And horses were not working over there, because for horses it was too difficult. Horses were used for the war. But it was oxen who were plowing, and usually in this one plow there were two oksen. And usually it was done that a young and immature, inexperienced oxen had to be taught how to work. And this young one was paired together with a strong, mature, and older oxen. And this young one, maybe in the beginning, didn't want to pull anything. He just looked around. It is difficult. But slowly he learned to do it. And it is said that quite quickly he learned from the experienced oxen how to face challenges, and he saw that this burden is divided into two parts. And of course, in the beginning, this experienced oxen was pulling all the weight, and then later this other one also started understanding something and also was doing his part. And this is what Jesus is telling here. So come and take my yoke and learn from me. And then he says that my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know, Jesus' methodology is not like I once read about dentist's advertisement that this teeth are repaired in while you are sleeping. And so you go there, you have this medical sleep, and then we wake up and you have Hollywood smile. And sometimes people think that Christianity is like that, that you would be sleeping and then 5 minutes before your death you would be woken up, and then God would say, I lived your life in a perfect way and you are going to heaven. No, it's not working like that. You have your challenges ahead of you. You have decisions and difficulties you have to face, so the attacks which are numerous in this world, because the mad dog whose name is Devil is walking around and he hates everyone. And it sometimes it seems the brighter is an individual soul, the more Devil hates him. But it is said here you will need to face these situations, but in this yoke, you would never be alone. Your difficulties, your responsibility, your risks, your burden, and also burden of and heaviness of attacks of the enemy, you will always share with somebody who is stronger than you, who already in the beginning knows the end. And like Jesus said to us, the one who loves you without any limits, Jesus, who loves you in such an ultimate way, he loves you so much. And the only way he could say to us is that as Father loves me, he also loves you. Jesus loves you, my dear friend. You can look very intelligent, young or old, successful or not successful, it doesn't matter. And if it resonates in your heart, it is God who is drawing you to Him. Jesus said that nobody is able to come to the Father to Jesus if the Father doesn't draw him. I have met people who say, yeah, I had these nudges sometime before, and then they become not so loud and quieter and quieter and quieter, and now I can't hear almost anything. And this is truth. We, as mortal beings, for us there is a time of grace when God speaks to us, and if we harden our heart, and we already heard a little bit about the hardened heart today. I've met a person, it was a pastor from the Soviet times, Lutheran pastor, who said, I don't have this regret for sins or feeling of guilt. I don't have anything of that. For me, salvation is lost. He was one of those who was hooked on the rod of the Soviet Union. He was going around the Soviet Union and claiming that Christianity is just trying to get money, that everything is staged and so on. And when I was a young Christian, I tried to speak to him. I didn't know his background. I was trying to tell about Jesus and his love, and it seemed that nothing touched him. And one day he looked with a desperate eyes towards me, and he said, "These doors are closed for me. I have lost my grace." And he turned back, and he did his monotonous work. And Lord, I don't wish this to anyone in the world, and I would like to tell you that He loves you so much. And you have to do something from your side. In James 4 it's written, come closer to God and then He would come closer to you. The truth is that He already stands at your door. He is knocking every year by year, and He is talking to you with various signs, methods, coincidences. God is saying, I am. I want to help you. I love you. But of course, we as people, we can reject Him, and we can reject, and then we can say that He wasn't able to appear as I want. He couldn't write my name in the sky and say, Vilnis, I love you. You know, God could threaten all of us into the heaven. He could just shake the earth. It's like a football ball is rolling, and He could just place his foot on it, and all the architecture and everything would just fall apart, and all of us would just be shouting. But God doesn't want to threaten anyone into the heaven. He doesn't want to break your arms and then somehow get you into the heaven. This is a voluntary decision, and Jesus is asking you in a very humble way, and He is also doing it today in a very humble way. And I would like to finish with a very, very short verse, John 1, 12 and 13. But as many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in His name. I was grown up in church, practically, because my parents were Christians. They were actively serving in church, and I knew that I hadn't received Jesus. I knew all the songs, all the Bible stories, and all the events in the Bible, all the personalities from the childhood. But I knew that if I had to die today, I am not saved. And then there was one day, I don't remember unfortunately the date, but I remember the feelings that as a sinner, as a person who is lost, as a person who cannot control his her life, don't understand themselves. I said I spoke to Jesus, Jesus, save me, be my Lord. And it wasn't like that I would try, I would look at others and then give it a try. No, it's not possible with Jesus. Either you give your life away to Jesus and burn all the bridges behind you, and He will be their only Savior and Lord, and you entrust all your life to Him, or you don't trust Him at all. There are no two possibilities. And I am very grateful. Because I started it as a young boy. Just a gray, nothing special. But he guided me through all my life. And it will happen also with you. It wouldn't happen just in one day, like Lieve said. It doesn't happen in one day. This is a journey. This is where you learn from him. You look at him. You listen to what your Lord is saying. You give yourself away as a disciple. It's not like, Pastor, how many times should I go to the service? Somebody comes for 3 times and understands as much as somebody else understands in 30 times. But we are talking about your relationship with somebody who loves you and has always loved you and will always love you. Your Creator, your God. My dear friend, if this morning you are among us and you would like to accept Jesus as your Lord, usually you don't have a very strong feeling, wish. Maybe you feel kind of shy, overwhelmed. But this today is a great opportunity. We have masks and also there is very dimmed light here. We look like those who were robbing the banks some time ago. And you can say your prayer. Nobody would see you. And this is your prayer. This is your decision. This is your coming to Him. Maybe you are listening to us online, my dear friend, and you can do it over there. I will say the words of prayer. And this is not a magic formula, some kind of words which you repeat and it's done. No, there should be your heart which says those words. And if you are prepared to give away your life to Him once and for all, and then learn from Him, follow Him, join the church. Of course, I don't know any other better church than Prieka Vests. And we will pray for you if you come here, and we will help you to become a disciple of Christ so that you can experience the riches of His mercy. You can do it today. And then we will also talk about those who are children of God. So let us, all of us, stand up. My dear, our dear Heavenly Father, this morning from all our hearts we give thanks that we can come to you. And those who want to accept Jesus as your Lord, and also believers, you also help repeat this prayer. So if you want to accept Jesus as your Lord, please repeat after me. Say, God, I believe that you are. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world, who died on the cross in Calvary instead of me. He suffered it for me. And then resurrected on the third day. Had victory over the devil, saved all those who believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. And today I proclaim Jesus Christ is my Lord. Say it once more. Jesus Christ is my Lord. I give my life to you. Accept me as one of your disciples. Thank you that you heard my prayer. And now I will pray for you. Heavenly Father, I am praying for everyone. Whether they are here or watching online, I am praying for them. And I break the chains of devil. I break the chains of sin and addiction. Chains of unbelief. In the name of Jesus. And I give thanks that your Holy Spirit can touch and can enlighten, make alive everyone of those who accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. Thank you for salvation. In the name of Jesus.
Ja tu esi šajā zālē,
if you are here among us, my dear friend, you can give thanks. It has happened. If you did it really truly from your heart, if you perceive it seriously, the heaven also perceives it seriously. And maybe you are somewhere far away, maybe you felt something, you didn't feel something. Anyway, something dramatic happened. God took out your stone heart out of your chest and put the real alive heart. And now you can read the Bible and it will open for you better than before. So please don't be alone. Write to us, call us. Call our office. There will always be somebody who will give directions to you how we can contact you and help you in your further nearest future. In Jesus' name.